he held heavy royal earrings. The whole corpus of the pre-Buddha states, where he's still a prince, he's just at the verge of reaching enlightenment, he's at that transition.
The Mauryan age that inspired the Ajanta cave painters is the first of three great ages of Indian civilization. The dynasty did not survive the death of Ashoka in 232 BC for long. In the following centuries, a succession of invasions from the north led to long periods of political disunity. It was not until the 4th century AD that a powerful new dynasty emerged. These were the Guptas, a succession of monarchs who also hailed from the state of Magadha, and whose first great leader was also called Chandragupta. Under Chandragupta I and his successors, India again became a vast, unified land. For 150 years, the Guptas presided over a time of peace and prosperity. But the most lasting legacy of the Gupta dynasty was the development of a new system of decimal numbers. The Gupta age was also an important time for Indian religion. The period between the Mauryan and Gupta dynasties had seen a steady decline in the practice of Hinduism. During this period of disunity, it was Buddhism that proved most dynamic. But under the Guptas, Hinduism recovered and absorbed many features of the rival faith. In the end, Buddhism would become little more than a fringe religion in India. To this day, it is the complex Hindu beliefs that dominate the spiritual life of the Indian people.
In the resurgence of Hinduism in, say, the 4th century, 5th century AD, we can see a counter-reformation by the Brahmins, an attempt to win back believers, and to win back social control. And we can see elements of Buddhism coming into Hinduism. It has been argued that the very form of the Hindu temple is borrowed from Buddhism. But there are also important differences. Buddhism itself had been moving towards a more populist stance during the later years, looking to be attractive to perhaps simple village people who were interested in personal devotions and having deities to worship. And it's almost like the two religions are competing for the same electorate. They're competing for the same vote. They're both trying to offer gods or idols that people can recognize and understand and worship.
Ancient Indian is a very complex period. You have the coexistence of Hinduism, you have the coexistence of Buddhism, you have the coexistence probably of a lot of nature-centered cults. Vishnu, that becomes extremely important, is a much more subservient kind of god, a deity in the earlier Vedic corpus, wherein by the later Vedic period, he tends to become much, much more important. He, in fact, takes on the role of the sustainer in later Hinduism. Brahma tends to become much, much more important. And Rudra, who is later known as Shiva, who is the destroyer. So this essential kind of triangle of creator, sustainer, destroyer tends to emerge as the primary Hindu corpus, set of pantheons that are then developed upon in later centuries and in fact survive down to the present day.
The Gupta dynasty ultimately crumbled at the end of the 5th century. Again, invaders from the north were involved. These were the so-called White Huns, a race whose domination of India would be brief, but whose legacy lived on for centuries. By the end of the 6th century, many of the invaders' descendants had become fully assimilated into Indian society. These were the Rajputs, warrior families who established petty states in north and central India. The Rajputs became committed to the Indian way of life, and the temples that they built remain the greatest of all Hindu monuments. Here at Khajuraho in the Madhya Pradesh region, the temples were constructed by a 10th century Rajput leader, a prince of the Chardela family. This is a huge complex of religious buildings dedicated to the Hindu god Vishnu. The mountainous Lakshmana temple is the most dominant feature of the construction, and its design inspired by a sacred Himalayan peak. But it is the carved sculptures on the temple exterior that make Khajuraho special. The carvings are highly erotic and leave nothing to the imagination. But these explicit images of physical love are thought to have been inspired by a deep sense of spiritual belief.
There are many, many theories about this, and not that there's been any one which has been completely explained. It is to do clearly with the notion of the auspicious, the notion of procreation, the notion of longevity. And in the case of the Lakshmana temple, the great edifice that actually celebrates a new kingship, declares the independence of a new regime. At the second level, there have been interpretations that these are essentially interpretations from the Upanishadic textual corpus, which talks about the unity of man with the ultimate, the fusion of the human soul with the infinite notion of godhood. And again, this notion of fusion is depicted in very explicit erotic terms. Alongside this, there is a whole textual corpus of Orissa, of the region, that talks about, in fact, the 16 auspicious forms of the woman and her role in any kind of religious endeavor. The Khajuraho temples, in fact, seem to illustrate these faithfully. The woman looking in the mirror, the woman plucking flowers. The third possible influence would have been from cults that were the non-conservative followings of the Hindu traditions, that is the tantrics. A lot of such imagery is in fact attributed to them. There is in fact a somewhat later text actually that enacts a life eulogy of two royal couples, the conservative over the non-conservative, the Brahmanical over the tantric, and the orthodox over the unorthodox. The interplay between these two seems to be a kind of a cultural backdrop for a lot of these temples, and clearly in that some of that ideology was incorporated within the overall iconological agenda of the temple is not unnatural.
Magnificent temples like this dominated 10th century India, both physically and spiritually. By this time, Buddhism had all but left the country to become established further east, in China, Korea, and especially in Japan. But now, a new threat to the Hindu faith was looming in the West, a young religion which already dominated territory from Spain to the Indian border. This was a very different kind of belief system to Hinduism. It was faith with one God that began to push towards India as early as the 8th century AD, Islam.
The Hindu civilization at this period had isolated themselves from the rest of the world. And the reason for this was that they felt that they were the most superior race. Their king, their country, and their knowledge was the best. So they discouraged any sea travel. And this was one reason that their defense from sea was very, very poor. Sometime in the early 8th century, the first invasion of India took place by the Muslim world. This was basically out of an extremely insignificant incident. An Arab ship leaving the coast of Sri Lanka and carrying goods and widows of tradesmen who had died in Sri Lanka was attacked by Indian pirates on the Arabian Sea. The governor of Iraq sent a letter of protest to the then ruler of Sindh for returning the goods and the women. Since the Indian ruler had no control over the sea pirates, he regretted his inability. The governor of Iraq saw this as an opportunity to strike, and this led to the first Muslim invasion of India.
By the beginning of the second millennium, Arab invaders had settled in the Indian territories of Sindh and Baluchistan. In the early 11th century, a Muslim warrior launched a series of terrifying raids in the lands of the Punjab. This was Mahmud al-Ghazni, the most unpopular figure in Indian history. His fearsome incursions impoverished his Punjabi opponents, and soon another Indian territory had fallen to the forces of Islam.
The incursions of Mahmud of Ghazni were essentially centered around the amassment of booty to embellish his own capital in contemporary Uzbekistan, i.e. Samarkand. That was his sole objective and sole agenda. And for this purpose, planned his raids into the northwest and then through to Delhi with great care. And in that sense, he did not prove to be a threat to the indigenous state of Islam or the pre-existing kind of sultanate states.
The Muslims that were here were a very diverse group of people. They had to be coalesced themselves into a kind of unity where Islam and being a Muslim in daily life meant something to them. The practitioners of Islam came in a variety of hues, a variety of interpretations of Islam present in North